Hi, welcome to the statics tutorials. So in this video we're going to look at how to be able to calculate the resultant of 3D vectors, and we have three different types of 3D vectors in this diagram. So the first one, F1, is defined by the coordinate direction angles. Remember, the coordinate direction angles are the angles to the positive axes. So alpha would be the angle to the positive x-axis, beta would be the angle to the positive y-axis, and we're not given that one, and then gamma would be the angle to the positive z-axis, and we're given that one. We only have to be given two out of the three angles, and we can calculate the third. So let's start with that. This equation always holds with the coordinate direction angles. Cosine squared alpha plus cosine squared beta plus cosine squared gamma is equal to 1. So we can plug this in. We have this angle to the positive x-axis, that's our alpha, so we'll plug in 60 for alpha. We don't have beta, so we'll just plug in beta as an unknown here. And then we have 50 as our gamma, our angle to the positive z-axis. So that's equal to 1. So we can just go ahead and get a decimal answer for the cosine here and the cosine here, square those, subtract those from 1, and then we'll just have cosine squared beta is equal to some number. Now when we take the square root though, remember that when you take a square root, the root can either be positive or negative. So when we take the square root, we get either positive or negative 0.5804. So we have to decide whether we want to use the positive root or the negative root. The positive root would give us an angle out of cosine that's between 0 and 90 degrees. Remember that cosine of 0 is 1, cosine of 90 degrees is 0, so that's where cosine crosses over. If we use a negative angle, that's going to give us an angle between 90 degrees and 180 degrees. So we have to look back at our diagram and decide whether we think this vector is going to be closer than 90 degrees to y or further away than 90 degrees to y. It looks like it's closer than 90 degrees to y. If it was going to be further away, it would have to be on this other side of the xz plane than what it is as shown. So we're going to take that positive root, and then when we take the inverse cosine of that, we get beta is equal to 54.5. From here we just plug it into the formulas for the coordinate direction angles. So we have f1x is equal to the magnitude of f1 times cosine of alpha, so we plug in our 60 here, and we get the 61.5 kilonewtons. If the angle is between 0 and 90 degrees, we get a positive number. If the angle is between 90 to 180, we get a negative number. And so this formula takes care of the positive and negative numbers on our components. Looking at F1y, we have the magnitude times cosine of beta, 54.5, and that gives us the 71.4 kilonewtons. And then for F1z, we take the magnitude times cosine of gamma, which is 50, and that gives us our 79.1 kilonewtons. Looking over here at F2, be careful, because initially this kind of looks like, hey, I got two angles, they must be coordinate direction angles, but they are not. This 40 degrees is the angle between F2 and the xy plane. You can see that because there's this dashed line that goes down from the vector, and then you can see this parallelogram that's actually a rectangle in 3D space that's sitting on the xy plane. And then you have a line coming out from the origin of that vector to where this line comes down. This is the projection of that vector, the shadow of that vector in the xy plane. So this little piece of it here, we could label this as F2 prime, that's the notation that Hibbler likes to use, and draw it as a vector, or we could label it as F2xy, because it's the xy component, both of them, of this vector F2. This dashed line, we can really think of this as being F2z. So realizing that, we can now break this apart into components. So with F2, we can say that F2z is equal to the magnitude. We've got a right triangle here, so it's going to be magnitude, and we've got the angle that spans the F2z, so that would be F2z being opposite to 40 degrees. So it's magnitude times sine of 40 because it's opposite that angle, and that gives us our z component of 97.1 kilonewtons. Now with the coordinate direction angles, we didn't have to worry about positive and negative signs once we got our alpha, beta, and gamma. Over here, you do. You have to say, hey, is this above the xy plane? In this case, it looks like it is. If it is, then this is going to be positive. If you have one that's coming down here under the xy plane, and there's a line going up to the xy plane, then it's going to have to be negative because it's a negative z component. Then we can get this component, we can get this component that has the x and the y components. It's going to be 151 kilonewtons times cosine of 40 degrees. We're using cosine because this is this side here that touches our 40 degree angle. So it's a side that's adjacent to our 40 degree angle. This gives us a xy component that's 115.7 kilonewtons. Now, when you're first solving these, you may want to go back and also draw a 2D diagram of the 2D component down here. So that's what I drew here. Once you've solved several of these, you may not need to draw these anymore. But looking at this XY diagram, looks like we're in positive X, looks like we're in positive Y. So I drew positive X, positive Y. I drew the vector going in positive X and positive Y. I've got an angle of 50 degrees to the x-axis, so I drew in an angle of 50 degrees to the x-axis. Then we can break this up just like it's a regular old 2D vector. So F2x, x component is adjacent to the 50 degrees, so it's going to be magnitude, but now it's just the magnitude of the xy portion, so 115.7 kilonewtons times cosine of 50 degrees, and we have to decide whether it's positive or negative. Looks like it's going in the positive x direction, so it's positive. And then for the y component, we have the magnitude, 115.7 times sine of 50 degrees. And that's going to give us the y component. The y side would be opposite to the 50 degrees. Looks like that's going in the positive y direction, so that gives us a positive 88.6 kilonewtons. Now for our last force, it's just going along one of the coordinates. So in this case, it's going along x, but it'd be the same procedure if it was just going along y or z or negative z or negative y or so forth. Its x component is just going to be 95.1 kilonewtons because it's going completely in the x direction. It's going in the positive x direction, so its x component is positive. Its y component is zero because the whole thing goes in the x direction. Its z component is zero because the whole thing goes in the x direction. Now we can get our resultant, just the same old, same old. We just have to also get our z components. So we'll do our x components. Our resultant in x is equal to, remember this just means sum or add it all up, all of your x components. So you'll start with this one, 61.5 kilonewtons. Get the 74.4 kilonewtons for F2, and then get the 95.1 kilonewtons for F3. Add them all up, you get the 231 kilonewtons. For Y, add up everything in the Y direction. That's our 71.4 and our 88.6. Gives us a total of 160 kilonewtons. And for our Z components, we add up our 79.1 and add up our, 97.1 kilonewtons to get a total of 176 kilonewtons. And then this problem it didn't specify, and the easiest thing is just to write it as a Cartesian vector. And so writing it as a Cartesian vector, you have the x component, and then you stick an I next to it to show that it's going in the I direction. Remember, I is the unit vector in the x direction. Has a magnitude of 1 and it goes in the x direction. 160 is the y component, so you write a j next to it, because j is the unit vector in the y direction. And then you have the 176 for the z component, and write a k next to it, because k is the unit vector in the z direction. Put the brace at the beginning and end, and then write your unit out at the very end of your Cartesian notation. So this would be kilonewtons. If it had asked you, though, for the vector in terms of the magnitude and then also the coordinate direction angles, you could calculate that as well. Just like with 2D vectors, you would take the three components, square them, and add them together. So that would be 231 squared, 160 squared, and 176 squared. Add that together, take a square root, that gives you your magnitude. So that's going to be 332 kilonewtons. And then you can calculate the coordinate direction angles for the resultant as the each component, so in this case for alpha, we're looking at the x component, so 231, divided by that magnitude, and then just take an inverse cosine. For beta, it would be the inverse cosine of the y component divided by that magnitude. And for gamma, take the inverse cosine. For gamma, it would be the z component, 176, divided by the magnitude, and then take that inverse cosine. Thanks for watching.